All right, what's up guys? So today we're gonna be talking about the Sony 90mm macro and how it stacks up against Canon's own 100mm macro L series lens. Alright, so of course macro lenses are important for a wide range of photography genres, everything from still life to macro photography, even to portraiture. Macro lenses are just great to have in your possession so that you can pull off all these different kinds of styles of shoots. And yeah, before we get into the comparison, let's just take a look at some sample photos that I've taken with the Sony 90mm over the past couple weeks. All right, so getting on to price. So the Sony 90mm macro comes in at $998 US. The Canon 100mm macro comes in at $799 USD, so a little bit cheaper, but the benefit of going with the 100mm macro is it's been on the market for a lot longer, and there's definitely a lot of used options out there on the market. So I was able to find one for $550 USD, which is around half the price of the Sony, especially when you factor in taxes. So, you know, definitely a lot of cost savings there. And yeah, let's see how it stacks up, see if it's worth the cost savings or if you should just go for the 90mm instead. All right, so a couple headline features with the Sony lens that might sway your decision. So first off, it has the focus clutch, which is really handy. You can just kind of pull back on the lens barrel, switches it from autofocus to manual focus. And yeah, it's a great way to engage manual focus when you're shooting and you're using two hands. You can just pull back, go into manual focus, adjust, and then pull it back forward to then engage autofocus again to keep shooting. The downside is that it can switch on you in the bag. So when you pull it out and you think it's an autofocus, it's actually manual focus. It's easy to kind of knock that switch and then kind of mess you up for a second while you try to figure out what's going on and why the lens isn't autofocusing. So some people hate it, some people like it. It's kind of like the aperture ring on a lot of Sony lenses. You know, some people like it, some people hate it. But you know, I didn't find it too bad personally. I actually quite liked having it. The only thing I didn't like is that when you engage the manual focus clutch, the focus point moves to whatever the markings are on the lens. So if you have it at a certain focus distance and then you want to just tweak it a little bit, once you engage the manual focus clutch, the focus is going to be in a different spot than where you were initially. And I kind of wish that it worked a lot more like the Canon full-time manual focus rings, because you know, if I'm autofocusing and it's at a certain distance, I can then just, you know, tweak the manual focus a little bit to get it to exactly where I want. It won't kind of jump around on me as soon as I engage the focus ring. So again, certain trade-offs. Definitely the Sony has a smoother manual focus ring, but definitely both lenses are usable in manual focus to get that really nice focus pull even at macro range. Another feature of the Sony is that it has a custom button on the side of the lens. This can be used to program, you know, a variety of different modes and, you know, basically do whatever you want. So if you want it to kind of punch in for focus magnification, you can set it up that way. If you want to engage eye autofocus, you can do it that way. AF on, you know, just whatever you want to do, you can set that up in the Sony menus, which is really handy. This is of course on the third generation Sony bodies that have a lot more custom options for your custom buttons. The Sony has a filter thread of 62mm, whereas the Canon has a filter thread of 67mm. Not a huge difference, not a big difference in pricing either. The Sony's a little bit lighter of a lens, definitely, and comes in a little bit shorter as well, although the Canon mount 100mm is definitely shorter than the Sony, but once you add the adapter and things like that, it becomes a little bit longer. So the Sony, definitely a tighter, more concise package, which definitely makes a difference. You know, when you're packing a bag full of lenses, it's great to have every little bit of space available, but definitely it's not like a huge, huge difference. What can be a big difference though is that the Canon actually goes down to f/32 instead of just f/22, which the Sony goes down to. And that extra depth of field can really make the difference, especially at macro ranges. I found it's really nice to have that f/32 just for that extra depth of field so you don't have to focus stack all the time. However, you know, as we'll get into a little bit later, it does come at the cost of a lot of sharpness. You're dealing with a lot of diffraction, which can definitely, you know, cause some issues in your image quality. And because the 90mm is a native lens for the Sony E-mount system, the stabilization works a lot better, so you get a full 5-axis stabilization, 3 axes from the lens and 2 from the body. And we have a test later on where we're getting to just how much of a difference that actually makes for your photography and videography. But just so you know, the Sony will have better stabilization than the Canon. And of course, the Sony lens will also be able to do video autofocus, which the Canon will not be able to do. The Canon can have pretty quick autofocus in photo modes, but that doesn't translate over to video. So if that's important to you, that's a huge feature. If not, I know a lot of videographers just go with manual focus for their videography, so that could be not a huge issue for you. All right, so this is kind of a controversial topic. Sony does this really annoying thing where when you actually increase the f-stop, the aperture blades close in. So it's great because it gives you a full-time, you know, sense of your depth of field before you take the shot. And then it doesn't introduce any flickering because the aperture lenses aren't trying to close down for every shot. It's just kind of statically in the same position. So those are some of the benefits of that kind of system. But the huge downside is that the camera really struggles to focus using autofocus continuous at f-stops like f11, f16, which a lot of people shoot at in the studio. So you have to resort to single point autofocus, which is a lot slower. You get this, you know, sort of pulsing to the autofocus as it's trying to hunt around and find this subject. If you're shooting moving subjects, you know, that's a huge problem that you can't use that continuous focus to get sharp shots every single time. But when you adapt lenses to the Sony, it uses the more conventional Canon kind of system for stopping down before the shot. So it's going to give you 2.8 all the time until you actually take the picture, and that at that point it closes down the lens, takes the picture, and then reopens again to acquire focus. So what's great about that is you can actually use autofocus continuous in the studio. You know, low light, you're using the modeling lamps to acquire focus. You can actually track subjects with autofocus continuous, no problem. And when you take the shot, that's when it closes down to f/16. You get all that depth of field in the final shot. So that can actually be really handy to use in the studio, especially if you're shooting at high f-stops. And it's something I really wish the Sony would be able to at least give the option to in the menus to be able to turn that on and off depending on which system you want to use. But for now, you know, going from the 90mm to the 100mm macro, that's kind of the differences in autofocus when you're using the lens for portraiture or product photography or anything like that. Okay, so talking about autofocus, let's get into some autofocus testing. So here I have a setup with 2 KMTV Boltsons and they're set up at different points. I'm just focusing between both subjects. So in photo, you can definitely notice that the 90mm with the native autofocus system is focusing a little bit faster. It's a little bit more accurate. There isn't as much pulsing going on, but you also notice that the 100mm is actually keeping up in terms of speed. You see a little bit more pulsing. It's definitely not as confident at acquiring focus, but in terms of outright speed, it is actually keeping up, which is really impressive for an adaptive lens. Again, this is on the Sony A7 Mark III, which makes a big difference because if you try to focus with adaptive lenses on older cameras, you'll definitely notice that it slows down quite a bit. So again, on the A7 III, the Canon 100mm macro actually holds up in terms of autofocus speed in photo and autofocus continuous settings. If you go to video, of course the Canon will not be able to do video autofocus, whereas the Sony tracks really quickly. I've actually had a lot of success with the 90mm macro on the A6400, which is filming me right now. It has an amazing autofocus system and it works really well with the 90 macro. Just be able to track subjects. You can get really close in on subjects and get really cool shots of just like hair detail and everything. And you can just autofocus the whole time, letting the camera figure out which subject you want in focus. And it's a joy to use. It's really awesome. But back to the comparison. So next we're going to test how the lenses actually track from a normal product photography range all the way to macro range as a way to test how the autofocus system keeps up, which can definitely be difficult in those macro ranges especially. So here's a side-by-side, and definitely you can see that the Sony is doing a little bit better at keeping up with the decreased distance to the subject. But the Canon's not doing too bad in this test either. Definitely in photo mode, the Canon autofocus definitely holds up. But of course, as I just mentioned, the benefit from the Sony is that you can do this in video as well, whereas the Canon, you're gonna have to do manual focus pulls, which can definitely be a lot more difficult to get perfectly right every time. All right, so next we're gonna talk about flare, and definitely the flaring on the Sony is a lot better than on the Canon, both in the center of the image and on the outskirts of the image. And we'll kind of come back to this later when we get to some images that are shot with both of these lenses side by side. The Sony just manages to eliminate the flares a lot better than the Canon. The Canon, you're seeing a lot more rainbow colors coming in. You're seeing a lot of flaring coming from the corners of the lens. And yeah, the Sony just does a better job overall. And if you've ever done macro shots where you're using backlighting on the subject, or you can see the light in the frame, this can actually be a pretty big deal when you're trying to get creative with your macro shots. But let's get into some images. So we're gonna start off with the landscape test. This is just both lenses shooting the same landscape subject, just testing how the lenses perform at further subjects. And yeah, let's get straight into it. So the Sony 90mm macro is denoted in red here on the left, and the Canon 100mm is over here on the right. And straight off the bat, you'll notice how much vignetting is coming out of the Canon lens. It's a huge amount of vignetting all the way around the sides. And yeah, let's jump in. So if we zoom into 100%, in the center of the image, we'll see that the results are actually pretty similar. Definitely not too much difference there as we pan down. And the big difference comes when you actually go out to the sides. So this is the 100mm macro in the corners. Definitely seeing a lot of softness. Of course, you see that a lot of that vignetting as well. Whereas on the 90mm macro, it's crisp and sharp all the way out to the sides. Like, this is basically as sharp as the center, which is really impressive. So definitely a big, big win for the Sony. Let's stop down to F4 to see how these lenses compare. You'll definitely notice the Canon vignetting is gone. And this is something that was really surprising to me, because the Canon actually has the bigger filter thread, which means it has a bigger opening in the front. And I thought that would contribute to less vignetting at 2.8. However, it must be said that this could be a symptom of the lens being mounted on the Sony with the metal bones. You know, not really sure if that's true, but regardless, this is how this lens performs on the A7 III. So at F4, vignetting's gone, which is great. But as we jump into 100%, we still see the corners lacking in sharpness, especially when compared to the Sony here on the left. Center sharpness, again, is very nice and sharp from both lenses. So we see the same type of performance all the way through the aperture range, both lenses looking very similar in the centers all the way out to the sides, but the Canon corners not quite catching up to the Sony's up until F22. So F22, if we zoom in, we're definitely seeing a drop in overall sharpness from both lenses. F22 is a really high f-stop. You're definitely dealing with a lot of diffraction. But as we head out to the sides, you'll actually notice that the corners look quite similar. So the Canon finally catches up in corner sharpness at F22. Not sure how relevant this is to people who want to do landscape photography. I would give the overall win to the Sony hands down. I think it does a lot better in this test, but this is how both lenses perform at F22. Let's look at F32 really quick, just to kind of show you how it performs. And if we jump into 100%, you'll definitely notice it's a very soft image at this point. dealing with a lot of diffraction at f32, so there's a lot of depth of field, a lot of softness, and yeah, this is how this performs at f32. Okay, so let's jump all the way to the other end of the spectrum and talk about macro photography. So here we are shooting, again, the same subject, a little bit different framing because the lenses have different focal lengths, of course, 90 for the Sony, 100 for the Canon, but the tripod is in exactly the same position, the lighting's the same, and the focal point is the same. So again, we have the 90 on the left and the Canon on the right. And if we zoom in, this is at 2.8, and we definitely see a very, very similar image. So I would say chromatic aberration levels are pretty similar, sharpness levels are pretty similar. The Canon definitely has a little bit softer bokeh, definitely because of the different focal length. But if we, you know, compare them apples to apples, both lenses look very similar. It's very hard to tell them apart. They basically have the same performance level at this macro range. And both these lenses really have the same performance all the way down the aperture range. Can't really pick too many things apart from both these lenses. They basically look exactly the same. But if we stop down all the way to f22, again, the Sony pulls ahead slightly. We're seeing a little bit better levels of sharpness coming out of the Sony here on the left than the Canon on the right. The difference is very, very small. Basically, these lenses are performing, again, identically to each other. Depth of field, again, you're getting a little bit bigger depth of field with the 90mm. But again, in terms of performance, Sony a little bit sharper now, but the difference is not huge. And of course, the Canon can go down to f32 now here on the right, which means you're getting that increased depth of field for your subject. However, it comes at a cost in sharpness. If we compare these two, definitely the Sony is just hands down sharper at this point. The Canon is definitely a lot softer. Okay, so we're gonna talk about stabilization a little bit. We're gonna start off with the Canon. So the Canon, I was able to get, of course, a 50th of a second, no problem, seen here. Let's zoom into 100%, just half the focal length, really not an issue for this lens and its stabilization. And let's jump down to a 13th of a second. Well, I was able to get basically a sharp image. I wouldn't say this is tack sharp, it's not perfectly sharp, but it's pretty close. So 13th of a second, definitely not bad for this lens. But if we jump over to the Sony, we've got 13th of a second right out of the gate. Nice and tack sharp. Definitely handles that no problem. And I was actually able to go down to a 6th of a second. Pretty sharp, not tack sharp, pretty sharp. And I actually managed to get a pretty sharp image at down to a 1/3 of a second. So from 90 millimeters, I could get a 1/3 of a second, basically sharp. I would say this is like acceptably sharp. It's not pin sharp, but definitely pretty good performance coming from the full 5-axis stabilization with the Sony body and lens combination. And here's a quick example of in video mode, how it stacks up. So both lenses with stabilization off, and then both lenses with stabilization turned on. And you can definitely see the difference in that. So I would say, again, the Sony is a little bit smoother, a little bit better stabilization coming from that body and lens combination. The Canon, not doing too bad. It's definitely usable, but I would definitely say that the Sony wins in this test. Okay, so now let's move on to the all important, possibly not that important, but anyways, I keep doing this test with all my lens reviews. It's the busy bokeh test. I basically just light, have one backlight and one side light, and I just shoot this crazy mess of cables underneath my table because it's kind of the most challenging for the lenses to render properly. And I do these tests with three different focus distances. So first off, we have close to the camera and all the way up in the right corner, a really challenging position for lenses to resolve properly. We have a mid focus distance with kind of more of a centralized focus area. So that's more of like a nice just let's see how sharp these lenses get, especially with macro lenses, should be no problem. And then we have a little bit farther again in the corner to see how it handles corner sharpness at a little bit of a further focus distance. So just a wide range of different things. We'll see how the bokeh handles these scenarios. We'll see how the lenses handle the backlighting and the flaring and the aberrations, and we'll get into all that stuff. So we have the Canon 100mm macro on the left here. We have the Sony 90 on the right, and straight out of the bat, we'll see that the Canon has much nicer bokeh. The Sony lens, we're seeing a little bit jagged lines here, a little bit more of like a nonagonal shape. Definitely not as round as the Canon here on the left. But let's look at corner sharpness at 2.8. And once again, you know, I'd say both these lenses are pretty identical. I might give a slight edge to the Canon. I think it's resolving a little bit better detail here. Once we get out to the extreme corners, I'd maybe give the win to the Sony. But again, that could be down to the difference in framing for both these lenses. But if we look at just sharpness, I would say the Canon's looking a little bit sharper here, especially on this 240 volt writing right here. In terms of aberrations, we're looking pretty identical. Bokeh fringing, again, looking pretty identical. So not a whole lot of differences in the image. Once again, we have that unfortunate circumstance where the lenses look really identical. So I'm gonna skip through a lot of aperture ranges and things like that. I'm just gonna give you the main findings from these tests. So once we stop down to F4, let's look at the sharpness levels, and now we see pretty identical performance from both the lenses. So identical sharpness, we have pretty much no aberrations anymore. Bokeh is looking pretty similar as well. The Sony definitely performs better stop down a little bit. The bokeh is a lot more round, a lot more evenly shaped, and the Canon is doing pretty well in that respect as well. But if we stop down to F8, we notice a lot of flaring coming from the Canon. Basically this huge corner flare coming in from the Canon. We're seeing some rainbow colors entering the frame. And on the right, the Sony is doing a lot better when it comes to that flare. This is again pretty surprising because Sony has a bit of a wider field of view, so you'd think that it would include the light a little bit more and even more flaring would show up in the Sony image, but that doesn't seem to be the case. I think the Sony is just doing a lot better at reducing all of those flares, and yeah, the Canon's just got this really ugly big flare in the left side of the frame. Okay, so let's jump to the mid focus distance, and we're focusing on this desk mount right here. And with the Canon on the left, the Sony on the right, I would definitely say the Sony is looking quite a bit sharper. It's just resolving those fine details a little bit better than the Canon. But, you know, both lenses, especially when you move up to this part of the image, looking pretty identical. It's possible that I just didn't get the focus exactly right on that thread. It's a bit of a small subject in the scene. But other than that, you know, let's look at bokeh. So I'd say the Canon's looking a little bit more harsh here. The Sony's doing a little bit better of a job at just rendering out that softness to the image in these more difficult transition zones. Again, if we look at aberrations, I'm not really seeing much. Both lenses handling aberrations really well. So we're gonna go all the way down to F11 and look at the flare. This time, the Sony seems to be doing a little bit worse with the flare, and the Canon's doing a little bit better. In terms of sharpness, we're looking pretty even now, so definitely the Canon caught up in terms of sharpness on the thread. And yeah, I would say both these lenses looking really identical, not seeing a whole lot of difference between the two of them. Okay, and we're gonna move along to the farthest focus distance. So this is focusing right here on this box up in the top left. And again, we have the Sony on the right, the Canon on the left. And you'll notice how much vignetting the Canon has once again at 2.8. And if we go into sharpness up here in the corner, the Canon's doing better than it was in the landscape test, but definitely you'll still see that the Sony is a lot sharper up here in the corner. Seeing a lot more texture on the box, a lot more texture on the railing. And if we come down here in the image, we'll see, you know, pretty similar levels of aberrations. Once again, the Sony might be losing out a little bit I have a little bit more aberrations than the Canon, but not a huge difference there. In terms of bokeh, we're actually looking really similar. Canon, maybe doing a little bit worse. I'm liking how the Sony's rendering out that particular spot. I'm liking how the Sony's rendering out that particular spot. I would say the Sony's doing a little bit better in terms of rendering the bokeh. But let's stop down to f4. Vignetting's definitely gone on the Canon. Jump into 100%. And, you know, I'd still give the win to the Sony in terms of corner performance. Similar to how we saw in the landscape test, we're not going to see a whole lot of difference here. Once again, in terms of bokeh, we're looking pretty similar. And in terms of aberrations, we're looking pretty similar as well. So not a huge difference, but the Canon vignetting is gone and it is definitely sharpened up a little bit in the corners. And just for fun, let's look at f22 for both these lenses and jumping into 100% here. Pretty similar. We're not seeing a big difference in terms of sharpness here. Aberrations basically gone. You know, we're seeing the same amount of flaring from both lenses, maybe a little bit worse with the Canon with this kind of star effect. So yeah, this is f22 for both lenses. Okay, so next up we have a chromatic aberration test. This is shooting a piece of paper with a lot of text on it at basically macro range. Both lenses here at 2.8, we have the Sony on the left, the Canon on the right. And if we zoom in, we are seeing not a whole lot of chromatic aberration. So that is great because, you know, using a macro lens, especially for wedding photographers, product photographers, you really don't want to be dealing with chromatic aberration when it's in the bokeh in these, in this kind of scenario where you have purple in the foreground and green in the back. That kind of aberration is downright impossible to get rid of, especially if you have a lot of colors in the scene. So for a lens to neutralize that straight out of camera is a huge, huge deal, especially when you have a lens specific to shooting details and product shots and things like that. So it's hard to pick a winner between these two. I would say the Canon is doing a little bit better of a job with the aberrations. We're seeing a little bit more green over here on the left than we are on the right. Seeing, you know, maybe a little bit more purple from the Canon actually than we're seeing from the Sony. But I would probably give this a tie. You know, you're not seeing a huge amount of difference between these two lenses. Once we stop down to f4, we're not seeing a big difference at all. Both these lenses, you know, looking pretty identical in terms of sharpness, identical in terms of aberrations, and even going out to the corner, these lenses just look pretty identical. So that's pretty much the story of the aberration test. I would say by around F8, we'd finally see all aberrations disappearing. We never really saw it being a big deal, even at 2.8, but at F8, I would say finally the aberrations are completely gone and you're getting a nice neutral color throughout the entire image. So no purple, no green or anything like that. Okay, so next up we have a bit of a funny test. I wasn't sure how to scientifically test this, but I wanted to see how both these lenses handle focus breathing. So I'm actually gonna bring up four images on this one. Basically, I took my C-stand and I just focused right down to the end of the rod. This is the Sony here on the top and the Canon here on the bottom. And you can see the difference in framing is pretty huge. The problem with these macro lenses is that the focus breathing is huge, especially at macro distances. You definitely notice it as you're focusing in and out. The framing's changing, the composition is changing. And this is why high-end macro lenses cost thousands and thousands of dollars, is because they get rid of that focus breathing, which is a huge issue on these more budget lenses. You know, I would have to give the win to the Canon on focus breathing. Definitely you're seeing that the end of the rod is smaller at macro distance, and it fills more of the frame at a regular shooting distance. So you're definitely getting less focus breathing. The Sony is definitely exhibiting more focus breathing. But again, this is a very non-scientific test. I just wasn't sure how to test this properly. But anyways, so I'll give the win to the Canon for this. But as you can see, the Sony's not that far behind. All right, so a quick little portrait test. Not a whole lot to test here. Basically, just seeing how it renders out sharpness in skin tones and maybe how the focus kind of falls off on the cheek and things like that. This is the Canon here on the right and the Sony here on the left. Just trying a bit of a cool lighting setup with the two tube lights on either side. I wouldn't really use this for portraits. I don't like the reflections on the nose, especially, but it does make for a cool catch light in the eyes. So, definitely an interesting setup, but I would definitely modify this for portraits in the future. If we zoom in, rather surprisingly, we're seeing a lot better levels of sharpness coming from the Sony than we are from the Canon. Based on all the other testing, I would have thought that the sharpness levels would be exactly the same. But we're definitely seeing that the Sony is a little bit sharper here. Just finer details on the skin and on the face. We're just getting a lot more contrast, a lot more bite from coming from the Sony. I will say though, this could be a preference thing. If you like the reduced sharpness coming from the Canon, especially for portrait scenarios, that could be a reason to go for the Canon as well if you don't like all this sharpness. Personally, I like it. I'd rather have the sharpness straight out of camera and be able to retouch it out than to just be lacking sharpness from the get-go. So wide open, I'd give the edge to the Sony. I think it's performing a little bit better. I'm not seeing a big difference in terms of out of focus, fall off or anything like that. Both lenses looking pretty similar. And as we move up to the hair, once again, not a huge difference. But in terms of sharpness on the skin, I would definitely give the win to the Sony. And when we stop down to f/8, the Canon here on the right, you're seeing a little bit of that flaring coming in from the tube lights once again. And if we zoom into 100%, this is where we don't see a whole lot of differences. I'd say a little bit more contrast again coming from the Sony, but in terms of outright sharpness, not a lot of difference between these two lenses. Okay, so this is something that actually might be important to a lot of people, is macro shots of flowers outside and how the lens renders the background and all the colors and everything like that. So here we have two shots, the Canon here on the right and the Sony here on the left, both shot 2.8 on hopefully the same subject. It's a bit hard because the wind's moving the subject around. It's hard to get the exact same shot. But as you can see, in terms of sharpness, we're not seeing a big difference. Both lenses rendering out these subjects perfectly. Huge amounts of sharpness coming from both these lenses. The big difference is definitely in the rendering. I would say the Sony is looking just so much softer, so much smoother. The bokeh just looks more round, it looks softer, it looks more diffused. We're getting a whole lot of weird shapes and just edges here on the Canon, which is definitely not great, especially when you look at this cluster, the Sony just looking a lot better. So definitely a huge win for the Sony. If we stop down to f/4 and we zoom in here, once again, we're seeing insane levels of detail and sharpness. Basically can't really pick them apart based on sharpness alone. But once again, we see the rendering of the Sony just being a lot nicer, just a lot more diffused. The Canon, these bokeh balls are quite big, but they definitely don't look as buttery and smooth as the Sony's. Yeah, definitely big win for the Sony and how it renders out the backgrounds in these complicated situations. All right, so conclusion time. I know that the Sony is twice the price, but it would be hard to say that it's not worth it. Like, we get better autofocus, better video autofocus, you get better stabilization for handheld, you get a smaller and lighter package, the corner performance is better, the bokeh background performance is better, the sharpness is on par. We're getting a little bit better sharpness in the portrait scenarios with the Sony. It just seems like every single test, it seems like the Sony is either as good or better than the Canon macro. So it'd be really hard to give the win to the Canon lens in this contest. If you are on a budget, and you only had $500 to spend, you know, the Canon is a good choice based on the fact that it basically holds up to the Sony at every single level. You're just missing out on all those extra features, which maybe you don't need. So the Canon lens could be a great budget alternative, but I would say for me, I would say the Sony is definitely worth the extra cost. Of course, if you're doing video, you know, no brainer, go with the Sony, get that video autofocus. I know you may not use it all the time, but just the ability to have it for the situations where you need it, you know, it's worth its weight in gold just to have those kind of features for your production. But aside from that, again, you're getting the enhanced stabilization, a little bit of a smaller, lighter package. And again, you're getting those nice, just diffused and soft backgrounds to your detail shots, macro shots, you know, just beauty shots, anything that you might be using a macro lens for. So yeah, to wrap this review up, I would give the win to the Sony. After using this lens for the past 2 weeks on these shoots and, you know, doing these makeup shots, powder photography, you know, just all these things where I need to resolve these fine details, I'm noticing just how much better the Sony lens is at resolving these details than conventional lenses. I think the lack of aberrations definitely contributes to that increase in sharpness. And even compared to the Rokinon lens, which I had before, I'm definitely noticing the backgrounds are a lot better. The level of sharpness is a lot better. And yeah, basically I'm looking to pick one up now. So I'm definitely kind of hunting the used market. There's not a whole lot out there, but you know, I'm on the hunt for a good copy of the Sony 90mm macro. So yeah, that's it for me, guys. If you are interested in purchasing any of those lenses, definitely check out the affiliate links down below, especially if you shop a lot at Amazon. It gives us a little bit of commission with no additional cost to you, so it just helps this channel keep going, keep running. And I'll also link below for the Rokinon lens, which I didn't include in this comparison, but I do personally own it, and it is a great budget alternative for a macro as well. If you did like this video, you know, check out our other videos. We have a ton of content on our channel. We have vlogs, we have behind the scenes, we have, you know, tutorials, we have gear reviews, and just, you know, a ton of content. So if you like this video and you want more in-depth comparisons, we have those on our channel. And definitely, you know, check out some of our vlogs and more of our fun content as well, because we put a lot of effort into that. But yeah, until the next one, guys, I'll get back to some of the more zoom lens tests, and hopefully we'll be getting the 24mm lens as well from Sony for a really fun trip coming up. So until the next one, I'll see you guys later.